Good morning. Sometimes it feels like not that much is changing. And then sometimes it happens all at once.
Please, Nicola.
She's off.
In my head and in my heart, I know that time is now.
Nicola Sturgeon, a fixture in British politics for nearly a decade, has quit. Even though this wasn't so long ago.
There's plenty in the tank at the moment.
The Labour leader was showing someone else the door, an effort to draw the line under the recent past.
Jeremy Corbyn will not stand for Labour at the next general election.
The Prime Minister would love to do the same, moving on after years of Brexit arguments. A deal on Northern Ireland isn't yet done, but feels that it's just about in reach.
We're engaging in those conversations with the European Union.
Next week, potentially?
All the time, and we have been for a while, but what I'd say is there is still work to do.
So we have one big question this morning. Are we waking up to a new political world?
Penny Mordaunt, the leader of the House of Commons, who wanted to be her party's leader too, is here. The woman who'd be Labour's Home Secretary, Yvette Cooper, joins us as well, with a new promise to crack down on bad behaviour. Hollywood royalty Hugh Jackman tells us about masculinity, Marvel movies, and why time's up for the monarchy in Australia.
I think Australia will become a republic at some point. It feels natural.
And with me at the desk to chew it over, the Conservative, Wendy Morton, who had the unfortunate job of being Liz Truss's chief whip, the author, Bill Browder, who says Vladimir Putin must be stopped, and the leader of the SNP at Westminster, Stephen Flynn, for whom Nicola Sturgeon was an inspiration. Hello and thank you for being with us. It's another busy morning. And Rishi Sunak will be waking up to more helpful advice from a former Prime Minister. Last time it was Liz Truss on tax. This morning, Boris Johnson. Well, sources close to him at least, enjoying telling the newspapers that Brexit must not be watered down, just as Number 10 hopes to have a deal over Northern Ireland in the next few days. Let's take a look at those front pages. That story's on the front of the Sunday Telegraph. But the Sunday Express is warning that the UK's armed forces are broken. We'll chat about that with Penny Mordaunt a bit later. On some of the other front pages, interestingly, the Scottish Mail on Sunday claims there's an SNP plot by those who are close to Nicola Sturgeon trying to install their favoured candidate as First Minister. We'll get into that as well. But the Sunday Times talking about the threat from Iran, and the Sunday Mirror has a story about Katie Price and her son, Harvey. Now, Stephen, you've said that Nicola Sturgeon was your inspiration. You lead the SNP in Westminster, but when did you hear she was actually going to quit?
Yeah, Nicola was indeed an inspiration for myself and for so many others. I found out very early on Wednesday morning what was to come that day, and like everyone, I was very disappointed.
And what did you feel? I mean, disappointment, yeah. Surprise, shock? Had there been any discussion in the party about it?
Yeah, shock, disappointment. I was gutted, to put it simply. Nicola was an inspirational leader, not just of the Scottish National Party, but of the Scottish Government too. Her warmth, her empathy, her humility, and indeed her honesty was all on show on Wednesday, as it has been throughout her reign. So to see her step away was deeply disappointing.
Some people, though, and she even acknowledged this speech in her speech herself, some people saw her as a divisive person too. I mean, do you think it is important, and will it be difficult for the party to move on?
I think there's always that inevitability in politics. The more you're at the front line, the more people will draw conclusions as to who you are and formulate opinions. But this is now an exciting moment for our party. We have the opportunity for change. Mm-hmm. I'm looking forward to seeing who comes forward from my colleagues in Holyrood, and hopefully we can move forward together.
And we'll talk about that a bit later on. But Wendy, obviously Nicola Sturgeon is a huge figure in British politics. The Conservatives liked to portray her as a sort of bogeyman. You've got Keir Starmer also this week saying that Jeremy Corbyn won't be able to stand for the Labour Party. The Conservatives like to portray him as a bogeyman. Two big
changes then? Do you feel this sort of ground is shifting at the moment?
I think there are certainly some big changes. I mean, you interestingly use the word divisive when it comes to Nicola Sturgeon and her politics in Scotland. And I think, you know, what I hope we will see now is less divisiveness and more willingness to work together and to deliver for the people of Scotland and the United Kingdom. But it's interesting, isn't it? You know, last week was a recess week mm-hmm. when Parliament wasn't sitting, and yet all this was happening.
Got up to all of these things.
I know. So, some of those things we will have to wait and see. But, it feels like there are certainly some shifts and some changes that are happening across the bigger political spectrum.
And, Bill, of course, the backdrop to all of this internationally is grim. Now, defence leaders and world leaders have been meeting at the Munich Security Conference this weekend as we approach the anniversary of the conflict in Ukraine. For years, you have been warning about Vladimir Putin, and we'll talk in detail about it later on. But how do you explain the danger to all of us as you see it?
Well, Putin has stated it clearly that Ukraine is just his first stop. This is a war not just with Ukraine, it's a war with the West. He has nuclear weapons. He is saber-rattling. He's telling us his intentions, which are bad, and we have got to do everything possible to contain him. And at this point, the Ukrainians are doing all of the really bad work, the dying on the battlefield for us. And we should do everything we can to help them.
Okay, well, we'll ask you more about that a bit later in the programme. Plenty of hard work and some fun ahead for you three a bit later on. And, of course, we want to hear from you too, as ever. What difference do you think this week has made to our politics? You can get in touch. Send us an email, kuenssberg@bbc.co.uk. And if you're social media inclined, you can use the hashtag BBCLauraKay. Now, with so much shifting, as Wendy's just been saying, we'll hear in a second how the government answers all of that. But first of all, let's talk about ministers' concerns over how the police have been investigating the case of the missing woman, Nicola Bulley, in Lancashire. The Home Secretary asked the police to explain why they decided, unusually, to release information about her private life. Penny Mordaunt is the leader of the House of Commons now, and formerly, Penny, you were a Minister for Women. What did you think when you heard what had happened, that the police had released this kind of information about Nicola?
Well, I think it's quite shocking, and I think that both the Prime Minister and the Home Secretary are right to raise concerns about this. I mean, the first thing I felt was for her family. I mean, it's bad enough having had your loved one go missing, but to have had all the additional drama that's accompanied this very tragic case is horrific. And I think it really does great with a lot of women, and we have to put up with all kinds of sexist behaviour in all kinds of settings. And I think to have it play out in this kind of environment is why people are so upset.
Do you think then that was part of this? Do you think that the police have displayed sexism in the way that they've dealt with this case?
I think that they clearly were motivated to try and explain why this case is a complex one. But I think there are serious questions to be asked about why they wanted to reveal particular
And there is a review into that, which the Home Secretary has asked for, but it's an internal review, so Lancashire Police are essentially marking their own homework. Would it be better if an independent figure took that on?
Well, I think the most important thing in this is that they find her. That is what all efforts should be focused on, and I just hope that family gets some peace soon.
Okay. Let's talk then about defence and what we've just been discussing with Bill Browder, that threat from Vladimir Putin, as we are a year now into the conflict in Ukraine. Now, you were Defence Secretary. I know you care passionately about defence. If we are in such a dangerous moment, as Bill Browder has just said, why can't then the Defence Secretary get the money that he wants?
Well, we're coming up to the budget. And if you remember in the autumn statement, the Chancellor said that we would be increasing defence spending. And I would say to anyone that is worried about this, look at what the Prime Minister has said. Look at what the Chancellor has said in the past. He, in fairly recent history, he was wanting to hike defence spending to 3%. And Ben Wallace has never been shy in saying what our armed forces need. We have always protected defence spending, even in the nightmare situation we inherited in 2010. And I'm confident we will do so in the future.
The newspapers right now are full of warnings from former generals, one of them telling the Express this morning that our forces are broken, questioning our ability to defend ourselves. Defence has had a real terms cut over the last few years, even though the budget has been creeping up.
And then we have this contradiction of Rishi Sunak standing on a stage in Munich yesterday saying to the world, we have to double down. Now, wouldn't it be better if that meant significantly more money for defence?
Well, we'll have to see what Jeremy Hunt says in the budget. But we have made commitments that we are going to increase defence spending. And there's the operational budget, which will come from the Treasury. But we also have to keep the core defence budget strong. The task that Ben Wallace has is not just keeping everything going and obviously supporting Ukraine. He's got to modernise our armed forces, and that means we've got to almost double run. We've got to rebuild these new technologies, but also keep our current operations very strong.
Would you like there to be more money for defence? I remember last time you were in the studio, you were running to be leader and you did want more money. So would you argue that alongside Ben Wallace?
From my maiden speech onwards, I have always been an advocate for strong defence spending. And we should never forget, this is the first duty of any government. It's a critical time, as the Prime Minister said. We now have to give Ukraine the tools to finish that job. We're going to be giving them more support than we have
and long range
time
missiles
last,
for the last first
year,
time.
In just the next few months. We have to do that. And of course, we're going to be ensuring that we have the resources to do that.
And should that include fighter jets in your view? I know the Prime Minister said nothing was off the table, but then the signals of it happening actually have been not strong. Should it include fighter jets in your view?
Nothing is off the table. The Prime Minister's asked the Defence Secretary to look at all the asks that the Ukrainians have made of us. We are doing a huge amount, and our focus is, yes, the immediate future and ensuring that Ukraine can have victory swiftly, but it's also about the long term as well.
But as a former Defence Secretary, is it your view that they should get fighter jets?
Well, I think we've got to look at what capabilities are going to be useful to them now.
Mm-hmm. We're doing
a huge amount in terms of training pilots. Mm-hmm. We are also looking at what other nations are doing. It's not been taken off the table, but I know that the Defence Secretary is looking at what is going to be useful now, as well as looking at helping them plan the shape of their armed forces in years to come.
Okay, let's talk about Brexit. Now, we know that Rishi Sunak is beavering away trying to get a deal with the EU to fix the problems with the special arrangements Northern Ireland got to guarantee against having a closed border on the island of Ireland, the so-called protocol we've all talked a lot about over the years. You were part of Vote Leave alongside Boris Johnson. Is it annoying that he's trying to stir things up and get involved in this debate?
Well, I don't think this is an entirely unhelpful intervention. I mean, I think the Prime Minister would give credit to his predecessors for enabling us to get this far. We have the bill and the command paper that was produced at the time. And in part, it is because of that that we are now able to have these negotiations, and the EU is talking about things that previously it said it wouldn't talk about.
So it's not unhelpful for Boris Johnson to be saying to Rishi Sunak, you better not water down my Brexit deal, you better not drop my bill, at a sensitive time when he's trying to get something over the line.
It's a reminder to the EU, the bar that they have to get over. But ultimately, it's not really about what Boris Johnson or any members of the House of Commons think about a deal. It's what the people of Northern Ireland think about.
But it is for Rishi Sunak, because if he gets a deal, you, Boris Johnson, are going to have to vote for it in the House of Commons. So it is about the party.
We don't know yet, Laura, what is going to emerge from these negotiations and what will then have to follow. I hope they do arrive at a deal, but the deal has to work for all communities in Northern Ireland. And if it doesn't, then it's not going to work.
Would you accept, as a Brexiteer, the European Court having any role? So for many people on your side of the argument, this was absolutely the critical thing, is that European judges should no longer be able to pronounce on what happens in the UK. Now, Northern Ireland is part of the UK, but under the deal, it's pretty likely that the European Court will have a role.
So we have to get all of these issues resolved, and that the Prime Minister has been very clear in the talks that he has been having, is that as well as the very practical issues that there are with trade and the unnecessary friction that's happening there, there are these more fundamental issues, that the democratic deficit, mm-hmm. ensuring that the people of Northern Ireland have a say, mm-hmm. through their representatives about any regulations that are going to
But for you as
up.
A Brexit Brexiteer, would you accept a deal where the European Court has a role?
Well, again, Laura, it's not about me. It's about the communities in Northern Ireland and particularly the seven tests the DUP have set out, which don't explicitly mention the court, but clearly they're wanting to protect the integrity of the United Kingdom, and they're also wanting to be able to have a say over any future regulations. Those are the tests this has to pass. If this deal does not pass those tests, it won't work. It's as simple as that.
And that's an interesting thing. So from what you've just said, you believe it's impossible to get a deal here unless the DUP is absolutely happy.
All communities in Northern Ireland, this deal has to work for all of them. This is why this is difficult, Laura. This is why we've still got a lot of hard work to do. But we have made considerable progress. And I'm not close to the negotiations, but I've been encouraged by what all parties have been saying, and all credit to the Prime Minister, the Foreign Sec, and Chris Heaton-Harris.
But just to be specific, though, in your view, if the DUP don't like it, there is no way that somehow the deal could be done.
The whole point of this is it has to work for the people of Northern Ireland. Everything else and what my colleagues might say and what they might do in a hypothetical vote, that is irrelevant unless it works for the whole of Northern Ireland.
Okay. We've talked this morning already a bit about how, you know, politics is shifting around a bit, and this tricky bit of Brexit might, you hope, be sorted. You know, Nicola Sturgeon's off. Jeremy Corbyn's not going to be able to stand for the Labour Party. The Tory Party's losing rather a lot of things that you used to sort of campaign against or that used to pull you together. Do you think your life's just got harder as a party?
Look, I think there are some opportunities in the changes that are happening. There's an opportunity for Scotland, I hope. I wish the SNP well during their leadership contest. But I hope that this will mean the Scottish government actually start to focus on the issues that matter to the people of Scotland. That is an opportunity, and I would encourage all the candidates in that leadership contest to talk about those real issues and start taking responsibility for the authority that they have. We have a comparatively new Prime Minister, although he's done a lot since he's been in office. I know he is very focused on setting out the vision he has for the country, but he understands that we have to get some pretty fundamental things sorted first. That's why he set out those five priorities, and that's why we're focused on those.
Well, it's interesting you mentioned that, because the last time you were here, you were hoping to get that job, and you say Rishi Sunak is still new in the job. But for a lot of people in your party, they look at him, they look at the polls, there's no budge, there was no evidence even of the tiniest of honeymoons. If you'd won, do you think you'd be doing a better job?
Look, governments and prime ministers are not tested in the good times. They're tested in tough times. They're tested midwinter, mid-war, midterm. That's where we are now, and in the middle of a recovery from a very severe pandemic. We are up against it, but actually, you know, I think the British people and my party are at our best when we're up against it. And make no mistake, Laura, I've just finished a tour in the West Country, and I've been visiting businesses and all sorts of community groups, but I've also been visiting our activists and our associations. We are resilient, and we are completely focused on serving the needs of our country.
And if you had to give marks out of 10 for your confidence that the Tories could turn things around, what would it be?
I'm going to be very confident, Laura. I will say 10 out of 10. And the reason for that is that I have seen the Prime Minister in action. I've seen how hard members of his cabinet are working. People like Steve Barclay, for example. You're going to start to see those numbers on health go the right way very shortly. We know what's required. We know what people are worried about. It's about access to healthcare. It's about stopping those boats. And it's about getting our economy back on track.
Okay.
That's what we're going to do.
All right. A testing list of targets for the government of Penny Morden. Thank you very much for coming.
Thank you.
It's great to have you in the studio. Well, she said the Conservatives were up against it, but let's see what our trio at the desk made of that. Wendy Morton is a former chief whip and Conservative MP. How difficult do you think it's going to be to get a Brexit deal on Northern Ireland, if there is one, through the party?
Look, I think, as Penny rightly acknowledged, you know, it's important that we recognise the work that has happened today, and that is ongoing. But I think equally it's important that we don't underestimate the challenge in getting it through. I think it is about making sure that the deal you know, that all parties are happy with that, or can live with it in Northern Ireland, the communities, also the business as well, because this is about trade. Mm-hmm. But when it comes to the Conservative Party, I think, yes, it's important that, you know, moving forward, that we take the party with us.
But is it really helpful then? You've got Boris Johnson looming over all of it, you know, nudging things to the newspapers. You've got Ian Duncan Smith, the former leader, writing in The Telegraph this morning.
I think we have to remember that we have had a referendum. It's important that we recognise that referendum, whichever side of the argument we're on. You know, I'm a Democrat. I was on the Remain side of the argument. My constituency is strongly Brexit, so mm-hmm. I'm very, very attuned to that. But we have to have something that works and that takes all the communities and takes our party with us. And it's important that we don't lose sight of that. I mean, if it had been easy, it would have been done by now, I'm sure.
But there are so many politics and grudges and long memories. You know, Ian Duncan Smith this morning has put a piece in The Telegraph saying that essentially, you know, the Good Friday Agreement is at risk here and the European Court therefore shouldn't be involved. There's this sense that Conservatives are chucking these rocks in the road of Rishi Sunak, who's trying to get something through. If you were still Chief Whip, how would you feel about trying to make it happen?
I'm no longer Chief Whip. I have life now, Laura. And I can say I never lost a vote when I was Chief Whip. But at times it can be quite a lonely job. But I think it's important that people who, you know, the different interests when it comes to Brexit, it's important that they are recognised and that people, you know, have their say. And, you know, those negotiations are still ongoing, but it's no easy task. And I'm quite happy I'm not Chief Whip.
You're quite happy you're not there, Stephen.
Yeah, look, we're in this situation because Boris Johnson lied. He said that his deal...
That's quite a charge.
No, it's true, though, because Boris Johnson said that his deal was oven ready and he made it out as if there'd been no issues. And quite obviously, there's extreme issues in relation to the protocol. Now, everyone wants this to be resolved in order to ensure that we have good relations between the United Kingdom and the European Union. And I hope that Tory members will reflect upon that next week, should it come to a vote. But let's be clear, Laura, Brexit has been an unmitigated disaster. 4% off of GDP. The issues that are facing our businesses in terms of exports are a result of Brexit. The issues facing our public sector in terms of recruitment of staff are because of Brexit. This is why 72% of people in Scotland want to rejoin the European Union. That's where Scotland's future lies.
Okay, Wendy's rolling her eyes, but I suspect we'll have a return to these debates this week in Parliament. I'm sure we will.
But you know, just to say that Brexit has, you know, hasn't worked, it's been a disaster. It's just not fair. There are Brexit gains that we've had. You only need to look at the development of the vaccine in terms of COVID. That's one really, really good practical example that's helped everybody across.
Okay, well,
there's
a whole debate about whether or not the UK could have done that inside the European Union. But you two, I'm sure, will have more of a chat about this later on. Let's talk about Nicola Sturgeon then, because that really has been the huge event in British politics in the last few days. Two contenders have now gone out there and said that they'll run, and we can show the audience images, first of all, of Humza Yousaf, who's the Scottish Health Secretary, and also Ash Reagan, who was part of the SNP frontbench but quit over the controversial gender reforms. Stephen, the interesting thing about this is, despite Nicola Sturgeon's many successes, she wasn't very good at making a succession plan, was she? There's no obvious contender.
I would contest that, and I would contest that wholeheartedly, because if you actually look at Holyrood, what we have is a number of individuals who have many good skills. They're excellent communicators. They've got extreme experience of being in government in difficult times. And
who's standing out then for you?
Well, I'm not going to pull my views out of the hat at this moment in time. I'll see who comes forward. There's still time for more people to come forward. But what I want to see from them is a clear plan in terms of how we approach becoming an independent country. I want them to outline how they intend to deal with some of the challenges that we face at home, because there is understandable challenges at home, and they need to do that, and they need to do that in the fullness of time.
Let's look at what it might mean for politics wider. So John Curtis, the polling guru, has told The Sun this morning, he's got his giant calculator out, and he reckons that actually Nicola Sturgeon's departure might give Keir Starmer a majority of 25. It's a gift for Labour, isn't it, her going?
Absolutely not. And if you look at the poll which came out last night, the first poll on the back of Nicola's departure or announcement that she'd be leaving office, it showed that the vote for the SNP was sitting at 43%, just a tiny little bit down from where we were in 2019. All that's happened is the Labour Party has replaced the Conservatives in second place in Scotland. Now, I know that many unionists want to think that the SNP are going to go away now, but I've got a message for them. We're not. We want Scotland to be a healthier, fairer and more equal place. We want to utilise our energy resources to deliver for the people of Scotland. It's absurd that in an energy-rich nation, the people of Scotland are fuel poor. We can solve those problems. We can rejoin the European Union as an independent nation. And we're just getting started, Laura.
We're just getting started. Well, we will see. Well, the campaign for the Leader is getting started, and hopefully we'll have some of the contenders in the for that job in the studio in the next few weeks. Now, Bill, of course, we raised with Penny Mordaunt what is going on with Ukraine, how Western leaders are taking on Putin or not taking on Putin. The UK's had this astonishing period of domestic political turmoil, but internationally, how do you think the UK's reputation is faring?
I think that the UK has been a big leader in this support, international support for Ukraine. Boris Johnson started out by, I think he was the first Western leader to really sort of raise the flag and say we need to stand behind these people, and Liz Truss and now Rishi Sunak. The thing which, you know, she didn't say it, but she might as well have said it, which is that we're going to supply jets to Ukraine.
Do you think that will happen?
Read between the lines. I mean, we were saying absolutely on no uncertain terms will we supply jets back at the beginning. Mm-hmm. Now we're saying, well, all options are on the table. We're going to train their pilots, et cetera, et cetera. We will supply the jets, and we should supply the jets because they need all the help they can get. Putin has got all the money in the world to bomb Ukraine, to do all this terrible stuff. He's got an unlimited supply of cannon fodder, of people to throw into the battle. Ukraine is a small, much smaller country. Mm-hmm. They don't have the resources. We should give them everything they ask for.
And you've spent years studying and exposing Vladimir Putin and how he's squirreled money around the world, made himself very rich. But you also, in your latest book, you describe him as a scared little man.
Yeah.
Why?
Well, so why are we even in this situation? And the reason is that for 22 years, Putin and 1,000 guys around him stole all the money they could from the state. And I estimate the amount of money they stole is $1 trillion.
$1 trillion.
They stole that. You can see it in London and mm-hmm. Eaton Square and Belgrave Square. And you can see it in the south of France and in Aspen and all these other places. They take all this money that should have been spent on education, on healthcare, on roads. And they bought villas and private jets and yachts. And you can do that for 1 year, 5 years. But you can't do that for 22 years and have the people not get upset. And Putin is not in the situation like Boris Johnson is. If he loses power, he can go on the lecture circuit or whatever.
And buy a big fancy house, it appears, in the Cotswolds.
Putin, if he loses power, he goes to jail, he loses his money, and he dies. And so what does he do in a situation like that? He's terrified of his own people.
And if the West doesn't take him on in the way that you say, basically everything in, all resources, every help that Ukraine asks for, what, in your view, having looked at it for a long time, is the consequences? I mean, we spoke to the Polish president last week, and it was striking. He said, if this isn't stopped, it might be Poland next, other countries in the Baltic. He was really clear.
There's no question. So Putin needs to be at war to distract his people from being angry with him because he's stolen too much money. And so Ukraine is not his ultimate target. War is his ultimate target. Conquest is his ultimate target. And so we would be totally naive to think that somehow if we were to like fudge the situation in Ukraine that he wouldn't be at the Polish border or the Estonian border. And if he is, those countries are our allies, our NATO allies, and we have a treaty obligation to then go to war with Russia. And if we want to avoid a war with Russia, which I think we all do, we should do everything possible to give the Ukrainians the tools so they can fight the war and win.
Well, huge pressure on Western leaders from what you say. And Bill, your new book, Freezing Orders, is out now, I believe. There's no question the war in Ukraine has given Western democracies a long list of problems. How to help Ukraine without creating a wider conflict, how to help their own populations with the side effects like rising prices. And as we talked about last week and in a couple of minutes ago, President Zelensky's asking right now for fighter jets. But so far, that request hasn't been met. I spoke to America's second most senior diplomat, Wendy Sherman, about what might be next.
As we hit this one-year marker, it's hard to use the word anniversary because no one is celebrating this horrifying, unprovoked, and just unholy invasion of a sovereign country by Vladimir Putin. But we're certainly coming to a one-year marker. And I completely understand why President Zelensky continuously throughout this has asked for everything he thinks his country needs. And I think we have all, the United States and the UK and 50 countries around the world have listened very closely and tried to provide everything they can at various points as needed in this very tough fight. The world has come together, and much to the surprise, I think, of the Russian regime, of the Kremlin, of Vladimir Putin, the world has stayed united, committed, and the commitment to Ukraine has not waned, because I think the world understands that a very important principle is at stake here. Not only the sovereignty, territorial integrity, and the right to make choices by the Ukrainian people, but it is true not only for Europe, but it is true for the whole world. If Vladimir Putin can invade a sovereign country in this way, others around the world will think they can act with impunity, unless they know that there will be a strategic failure, as there is been for Vladimir Putin, and as there will continue to be as Ukraine wages what will be a winning effort here, and is already a winning effort here, because Russia is suffering badly as a result of this horrible invasion.
But will the United States send President Zelensky the jets he's asking for?
Well, President Biden has said that at this moment, F-16s from the United States are not going to probably be there. But I know the UK is going to train Ukrainians. I think there are other countries that may be considering them. And look, at every point, we have looked at what's been asked. We have provided whatever is possible. We completely understand the request by the Ukrainians, and the entire world has tried to fulfill them.
Obviously, on both sides of the Atlantic, we've been watching with great interest these Chinese spy balloons. Has this been happening for a long time, or is it something new?
We have told countries around the world that our understanding is this has gone on for a bit of time. Exactly how long we'll leave to others to think through. But it has not just been across the United States, but other countries as well. I do think that we've been very clear about the actions that we've taken. But I want to say to your listeners and to the whole world that we understand that the People's Republic of China and the United States of America are two great powers, that we need to have lines of communication, which we kept throughout this unfortunate time, that we took the action to protect our citizens and our security, ultimately taking down this balloon. But it is very important that we not only continue our communications with the People's Republic of China, but that Secretary Blinken, who postponed his trip to Beijing, connect again with the PRC interlocutors and ultimately put that trip back on the schedule.
And are you going to try and stop China from doing this again?
Well, we've been quite clear since the beginning of this episode in direct communications with the People's Republic of China that sending a surveillance balloon over any territory of the United States is unacceptable, a violation of our sovereignty, and a violation of international law. So we've been very clear about how we think about what has happened here, the actions that we took to protect our safety and security.
The previous administration in Washington called China the threat of the century, yet President Biden says they're stiff competition. Is that all they are? Or would you spell out that China is a threat in your view?
There's no question that the People's Republic of China is the pacing challenge for certainly this decade, if not into the further future.
We've had warnings in this country that we are vulnerable to spying by the Chinese through technology. Do you think British and American citizens are being spied on by actors on behalf of the Chinese government?
We have thousands of chips in any of our cars. We all live on our cell phones. And we have to understand that all of these devices can be used as surveillance vehicles if used in the wrong way. And so we all have to be mindful. We're all much more aware of cybersecurity. We're all taught about hygiene on our computers, good hygiene for our use of technology.
What about the Chinese-owned social media platform TikTok? Would you be happy with younger members of your family using it?
Well, you know, these are very tough decisions for any family. The United States government has made a decision that none of us can use TikTok on any of our official devices. I think that was a very, very sound judgment. And I would certainly tell any young people in my family to think twice about being on TikTok. For all of the reasons, though, I understand their concerns about wanting to be able to be on these social media sites, but they need to understand that they're complicated. And I think we will all have much more discussion going into the future about how to manage technology in a way that preserves our freedom, our values, and our right to make choices and decisions without feeling like others are making them for us.
You started your career as a social worker. Are there skills that you learned then that you use now when dealing with tricky customers like Putin and tricky situations?
Absolutely. I was blessed to learn a lot of both clinical skills, how to relate to people, how to understand them, as well as how to organize people to reach an objective. And I often joke, only half jokingly, I'm still a social worker. My caseload has just changed.
Wendy Sherman, Deputy Secretary of State, thanks so much for being with us. Now, tough on crime, tough on the causes of crime. Heard that one before? One of the most quoted new Labour slogans, of course, that seems to be making somewhat of a return. The party's making a new set of promises to tackle crime and antisocial behaviour, with an idea of new so-called respect orders. Well, the woman who wants to introduce all that as Home Secretary if the party wins the election is Yvette Cooper, and she's here. Thank you for coming in, Yvette.
Good morning, Laura.
First of all, I want to talk about Nicola Bulley, because people have been following this story very closely. Now, you, earlier in the week, asked questions of Lancashire Police Force when they put private information about her into the public domain. What was your concern?
So I think this is a really unusual level of information, including health information, to be provided. That's obviously why there has been so much concern about it. I think since then, the Information Commissioner has said that he is now going to look into this, and also they have internal reviews. So I think we now need to let those take their course, and the focus now needs to be on Lancashire Police continuing with their investigation, and also on the support for the family, because I am very worried. I think the nature of the social media speculation and frenzy that there has been around this case, it's really important that Nicola's family also gets support.
But have you been given new information in light of the questions that you asked? And can you tell us what you've been told?
So we have had some further information from Lancashire Police, but I think the main issue still stands, which is about just really the level of personal information and how unusual this is. But there are also unusual circumstances in this case as well. So that's why I think this should properly be done, looked at by the Information Commissioner and by the review, because my concern as well is that we focus on that at the expense of focusing on the search for Nicola, which obviously has to be the priority for Lancashire Police right now, and everybody should be supporting Lancashire Police in that investigation and also supporting Nicola's family at a really difficult time.
But more broadly though, and I know you've studied these issues carefully, do you feel that there is a broader issue with how the police sometimes see women? Do you think that women can trust the police with their personal information and the kind of private information that sometimes is so vital for investigations but also deeply personal to people?
So I think we should almost sort of put this case aside.
Indeed,
because there's
a broader
obviously
question.
Exactly, there's an issue there just in terms of that investigation has to take place. There is a wider issue about the way in which the police has dealt with particularly violence against women and girls, and of course with standards around misogyny and around approaches towards violence and abuse within police forces themselves. We've obviously had the terrible cases of Wayne Cousins and David Carrick, neither of whom should have been police officers, and where really standards have not been high enough. And that's why we've called, and I've called, Labour's called for an overhaul of standards, an overhaul of the approach, so that you have stronger standards on vetting, something as basic as if someone is facing an investigation for rape allegations or for domestic abuse allegations, they should be suspended as a police officer, not just shifted to different duties. They should be suspended. So let's get those higher standards in place. Mm-hmm. There are officers across the country who are doing amazing work mm-hmm. to tackle violence against women and girls, to support vulnerable women, and to do really good work. But that is being undermined unless you have those strong standards
in
place.
And you said there is a problem there. Now, let's talk about some of your new plans mm-hmm. on tackling antisocial behaviour. Now, you have a plan for so-called respect orders. Now, do we really need another tool? Because there are criminal behaviour orders. There used to be ASBOs under the new Labour government. What's the point of having another tool, another announcement?
So we need three things. We need stronger prevention work. We need more police officers, particularly neighbourhood police officers on the beat. And we're proposing 13,000 more neighbourhood police officers and PCSOs across the country. And also we need the stronger enforcement against the repeat antisocial behaviour and abuse that is dragging communities down and making people's lives a misery. And just to give you an example of an area where really the Conservatives have weakened enforcement and it's been damaging, and the respect orders would help. I spoke to an officer who has somebody who has been real causing havoc in a town centre, including intimidating people, particularly intimidating women, some drunken behaviour, also abuse of shop workers. The council and the police want to be able to ban this individual from the town centre. He's preventing people going shopping and feeling safe. But at the moment, the antisocial behaviour injunction that the Conservatives brought in, they can't arrest him if he's banned and if he still turns up. They haven't got that power of arrest. Mm-hmm. There's no criminal sanction. So what our respect order would do is give those police officers the tools. If you've got that repeated antisocial behaviour by adults that's causing havoc, you need to be able to take the action, because it is just unfair
community. But when you look at it, and that sounds like a terrible situation, but when you look across the piece, actually the latest information from the Crime Survey of England and Wales, which is a huge piece of work, actually suggests that incidents of antisocial behaviour are going down. Now, isn't there a risk that by doing this, okay, it gets you a headline, but doesn't it actually risk demonising some people around the country? That's what happened with ASBOs, and it almost became a sort of badge of honour from some people who like to cause trouble, but also it criminalised many people, perhaps unnecessarily.
Well, these respect orders will be targeted at adult repeat antisocial behaviour that is causing havoc, causing a misery. So we know from talking to police officers, council enforcement officers across the country, that there is a gap. The way in which the Conservatives weakened the powers means in that town centre example,
they would dispute that,
example,
but that's as you see it.
But it really is. And, you know, there'd be plenty of police officers across the country who would say the same thing. It is targeted, and antisocial behaviour in town centres, I think, is a particular problem. There's been a 30% increase in the vandalism and criminal damage affecting town centres in just the last year alone. And I've spoken to a woman who said she doesn't want to shop in town on her own anymore. I've spoken to a business owner who said she closes at 4 rather than 5. The neighbourhood patrols have all gone and it's been really damaging. So we would bring back those town centre patrols, bring back the police into the town centre, mm-hmm. get neighbourhood police back on the beat and give them those sensible powers to take fast action, because no one should have to put up with that kind of abuse and repeated misery affects our towns.
Aren't you though actually bringing back some, you know, new Labour classics, tough on crime, tough on the causes of crime? Is the party under Keir Starmer now unashamedly new Labour again?
On tough on crime, tough on the causes of crime was right then and it's right now. And at the moment, the Conservatives are doing neither.
But so is Keir Starmer's Labour Party new Labour?
Well, on that particular tough on crime approach, then we are unashamedly saying, look, you've got to do both prevention and tackle crime. Now, you've also got to deal with the new issues, so fraud and new technology and some of those challenges.
But on the policies of this, it's interesting. So, unashamedly new Labour. Because some people who voted for Keir Starmer in the leadership contest a few years ago, when he promised essentially to keep most of Jeremy Corbyn's agenda, some of them might perhaps quite rightly be quite cross to hear you sit there and say this morning, yeah, we're unashamedly new Labour.
Well, what we're saying is we're going to deal with the challenges that the country faces now in the 2020s. Those are very different to the kinds of issues that we faced in the 1990s, in the 2000s. There'll be some things, though, that we did when we were in government that actually we should be pursuing again, and that does mean was one of those, getting neighbourhood police on the beat.
Okay.
There'll be other areas where actually we want to do things differently, for example, on zero carbon, And for example,
and that's a new challenge with
exactly.
a new plan. And,
new
and I'm
challenge.
Sure we'll talk about that a lot in the next few months, I'm
the
sure.
issues that we, you know, the issues that we deal with now.
I just finally want to ask you about Ukraine. Of course, the backdrop to everything at the moment is the conflict. But you and your husband have been one of the many thousands of families across the country that's actually taken in a family, some refugees. You have Ava and Katerina, mother and daughter, who've become, I think, you know, part of your household in Yorkshire. Have you talked to them about the anniversary of the conflict? What will you be marking it in any way? Or what have they brought to your family, perhaps?
Yeah, it's really hard. We have the mum and two children staying with us, and their friends staying just around the corner. Mm. And the thing that was really almost the hardest listening to them talking about it was describing how they had to leave. And the bombardment started and they left within 20 minutes and had to flee their home. And so, you know, you have a teenager having to pack everything into his bag, just such a rush. All of the things that they and countless other families went through as a result of Putin's illegal war. And they're, you know, they're such an impressive family. We've got these two families just around the corner. It's so impressive the way that they have dealt with this. And we love having them with us, but also hate the fact that their families have been split up as a result of this just truly appalling war.
Okay, Yvette Cooper, we must leave it there. But thanks so much for coming into the studio. It's great to have you, as always. Now, last week I promised you a Hollywood megastar, and I like to keep my word. So the actor Hugh Jackman dropped by the studio this week. We talked about his Marvel movies, masculinity, and his new film, The Son, which tells the story of a father and son in real distress. And it was filmed during the claustrophobia of lockdown. Here he is.
It was a hard shoot. It was an intense shoot, but I have such memories of warmth about it, because we really had to rely on each other. We didn't rehearse. The director did not want to rehearse. He wouldn't allow us to watch the monitor. So we were in a kind of bubble, and we had to kind of just let go and trust each other. I knew that this was a part I knew how to play. I understood the emotions. I understood that battle of someone who's probably doing too many things at once, mm-hmm. but feeling that they've got everything under control and they can handle everything. It's a little similar to me, and trying to balance every part of their life.
Beth, sorry, Kate's just here to talk to me about Nicholas. We've just found out he hasn't been going to school for almost a month.
It's not only that, Peter. He's not well. You need to speak to him. I don't know what to do anymore. He needs you, Peter. You can't just abandon him.
I'm not abandoning him. Why do you keep saying these things?
You've said, after making such a personal project, now you've opened up and you've said you're finally, you used the word finally, having therapy to explore some of the issues that you had with your own mother. Can you tell us about that?
Well, it's not really that I'm exploring issues with my mother. I guess I'm exploring issues within myself. It was something that I had never done. And I thought, why wouldn't you? What's my reticence? Why am I holding back? Why wouldn't you think, I mean, I have an acting teacher, I have a singing teacher. Why wouldn't somehow emotionally or through your life or the things that are going on in your life, why wouldn't you get help? And so I did, and it radically changed things for me. Understanding of why I do certain things, why I think in a certain way, why there's certain patterns in my life, why it's so hard to break those patterns. And I guess I unraveled it a little bit, and that's probably, hopefully it's a good thing.
In what kind of ways has it changed you?
I mean, just this interview. I don't think I would have done this interview 2 years ago. I wouldn't have said what I just said. I would have thought, oh no, that's not something worth sharing. Don't share that. And I'm just not so frightened of it anymore. And I've realized also through this movie that being vulnerable is actually fine. It's something that everyone relates relates to, and even my children, I'm more vulnerable with them.
But do you think that young men feel a pressure that they can't do that?
I do think that exists. I don't think it exists as much as when I was younger. Mm-hmm. If I could paraphrase it or generalize it, I feel there was some kind of assumption that boys had to be made into men. You have to toughen them up. And I actually have great hope, and I see it in my kids and their friends, They're much more open about talking about their feelings. They're much more vulnerable.
There is a strand, though, of what's sometimes now branded as toxic masculinity. Mm-hmm. So in the UK, for example, there's been a lot of concern about an online influencer called Andrew Tate. Mm-hmm. Don't know if you've heard about him, but he produces very misogynistic content. Do you worry about that kind of toxic masculinity, that kind of narrative influencing younger men?
Do I worry about it? I don't worry about it with my children. I think we have open conversations and I think they're exposed to many, many different things. I think there is a lot of unfiltered opinions and information coming through and often appearing as fact as opposed to opinion. And I do think that's a worry.
So you've been playing the character of Wolverine for a long time. Mm. Is Wolverine a good role model?
Well, I don't think I'd want Wolverine to be your only role model for masculinity, you know. And what I've tried to bring to it, I think what drew me to him was not his superhero abilities, but the pain that he's trying to live with and trying to reconcile. He's not a nice man. I think ultimately he's a good man.
I mean, he's a pretty angry person. You say a good person, but should Wolverine have therapy?
Absolutely. Whether he'll go, I don't know. I think in some ways Professor X is his therapist, trying very, very hard.
Last time you said you were never going to do another film again. And of course you are now doing another film.
Yeah. Never trust an actor.
Never trust an actor? I mean, is this going to be the last one or would there be another one after that?
Never trust an actor. I'm not going to say anything. I honestly, truly meant it. And I honestly can tell you Ryan would ring me weekly. Are you sure? Are you sure?
So it was about then your relationship with your frenemy. I mean, Ryan Reynolds, you and he love to tease each other and prank each other, you know, across mm-hmm. different sides of the Atlantic and wherever you are in the world. What's it really about?
What's it really about?
Yeah.
That's a really good question. It's sort of a sibling rivalry. Me being the older, wiser, smarter, whatever adjective you like that's positive.
Just all the good ones are for you and all the negative ones are for him.
I mean, exactly.
Talking of which, this week you posted a picture of yourself doing what looks like a completely ridiculous bicep curl.
Right.
Now, I think that was directed at him
100%.
To show just how great shape you're getting into for this
film. He lay down the gauntlet. I go, oh, this training's hard. And then I saw his post. I'm like, oh, I see. All right. Is this how it's going to be? You
know? Ryan Reynolds has made a lot of people in Wales very happy by buying Wrexham Football Club. Would you be tempted to buy a sports club? Man U's up for sale in the UK.
I will admit to you that when Ryan bought that team, I did get more than one offer from rivals to that team for £1 to come in as a co-owner.
Really?
And that did seriously tempt me, just sort of, but I thought...
From who? You must tell us. Come on, it's only telling me.
I can't tell you. But Michael B. Jordan I was with last night, and he's a co-owner of Bournemouth. And I was like, you know what? This whole thing of outsiders coming in buying football teams, it feels a little, I don't know, easy. So I've decided to go one step further.
What are you going to do?
I'm actually going to try out for the team. So Delia Smith, Stephen Fry, I'm coming to try out. I think if I really want to stick it to Ryan Reynolds, mm-hmm. If Wrexham get to play Norwich, because obviously there's a different level here, I think it would be best if I was heading in the winner.
So Hugh Jackman could be a canary, which is...
I could be a canary.
A canary. It's the BAFTAs this weekend.
Yes.
Of course, it's the Oscars not too far off. Do you think it's time a superhero won the Oscars? I mean, do you ever, as a Marvel star, as Wolverine, do you think there's too much snobbery towards action movies?
I do, actually. It's interesting. It's not dissimilar with comedy. I think comedy as well gets overseen, you know? And I'm not sure why it is, but anyway... Yes.
Now, Jacinda Ardern sat in that seat, and she said that she did believe that New Zealand would become a republic at some point mm-hmm. in her lifetime. Would you like to see Australia become a republic?
I think Australia will become a republic at some point. It feels natural. It feels like something that is, I would guess, inevitable, and I would guess would be a natural part of evolution of a country, you know. I'm a British citizen as I am an Australian citizen. I don't know if people know that, but I am, and my parents grew up. My father made us stop doing whatever we could to watch the, in 1981, to watch the wedding of Lady Di and Prince Charles. We had champagne, so I grew up with a lot of that. Mm-hmm. I've met the Queen on several occasions, the Queen Mother and Prince Charles, and I've met them, and I see and feel a real genuine desire to be of service to the public, and I appreciate that and I admire it, and I only wish them the best.
But you do think Australia will go its own way?
I think it's inevitable at some point.
Yeah. Jackman, thank you so much for coming in and for talking about such a range of different topics.
My pleasure. Thanks.
And you can see an extended version of that interview on the iPlayer now. Now, it's nearly 10 o'clock. Our hour together has raced by like the very eventful last political week. This morning, I asked Penny Mordaunt if there was any way forward for a deal on the Northern Ireland Protocol that the DUP didn't like.
The whole point of this is it has to work for the people of Northern Ireland. Everything else and what my colleagues might say and what they might do in a hypothetical vote, that is irrelevant unless it works for the whole of Northern Ireland.
Okay. Penny Mordaunt there. Now, we've had a question from our viewer, Richard. We do read your emails, remember, and he wants to know, why did the SNP come on and only talk about Brexit and independence? So, Stephen, I'm going to ask you about something else. Hugh Jackman said that Australia should be a republic. Would an independent Scotland be a republic or want to keep the monarchy?
I think Hugh Jackman said in time, through an evolutionary process, that may come to pass, and I would probably be quite sympathetic to a similar evolution in Scotland in time, yeah.
That's interesting, because in the last independence referendum, I remember the SNP said very clearly they'd like to keep the Queen, but that's a different position.
No, I'm quite happy with the status quo as it stands, but over time it may well be that the people of Scotland decide for an alternate vision, but that'll be for the people of Scotland to determine.
OK, now, Wendy, we've talked a lot about the Brexit deal and the chances of it getting through Parliament this week. You did say, as Chief Whip, you never lost a vote under Liz Truss, but there was a vote that was pretty chaotic, and then the government fell the next morning, so I'm not quite sure if that's something that you want to boast about. But if there's a deal, give us your prediction. Would it pass through Parliament?
For a deal to pass through Parliament, it would have to have, I believe, the support of the communities in Northern Ireland. It would have to have the support across our party and the DUP. But I don't have a crystal ball. Who knows? And the negotiations are ongoing. But the point here is that we have to respect that referendum that we had. We have to respect all the different parties in this. This is what makes it so complex.
But what's your hunch, though? I mean, do you think that
I'm not a betting lady. And, you know, as a former Chief Whip, you would always look at the numbers and try and work it out. Let's just wait and see, and let's give it the best chance that it can, because that's, I think, everybody wants this to succeed. Mm-hmm. But for it to truly succeed, all the parties have to be, you know, bought into the process.
And Bill Bredder, just finally to you, we heard a few minutes ago from the second most senior diplomat in the US talking about, you know, how actually her skills as a social worker were quite handy for dealing with Vladimir Putin. But what skills, what strength do you think the West needs right now?
Well, I think that we need to be criminologists, not political scientists when it comes to Putin. The guy's a mafia thug. He's a mass murderer. He's just the most criminal guy out there. And there's still a lot of talk about we need to give him an off-ramp, we need to negotiate. I don't believe any of those things. He's a criminal. He needs to be soundly defeated. And that's the only thing that's going to bring peace to this part of the world, is if Putin is no longer in power and if Russia is no longer a threat.
So in your view, Western leaders who say, actually, we have to find a space for compromise, eventually there must be some kind of peace talks, you're clear they're wrong?
There can't be any peace talks because Putin has no intention of peace. That would just be a short-term placeholder until he goes to war again.
Okay, well, all three of you, thank you so much for joining us this morning. We've covered such a range of different conversations, but we're very grateful to you for being with us and giving us your insight. Big thank you to my companions who've been at the desk. And whether you notice it or not, politics is always changing bit by bit with every new plan, every row, every vote, every day. But every now and again, there is a bigger gear change, and it does feel in some ways like we are moving through one right now. With the departure of Nicola Sturgeon, we've talked about the edging out of Jeremy Corbyn from Labour, and maybe, although it's still a big maybe, the end of the arguments over Northern Ireland and Brexit. Perhaps some of the fundamentals are on the move. But if you've been paying attention this morning, which I know you always do, that doesn't mean that peace and harmony is about to break out. Most of all, the horror of the ongoing war in Ukraine. which shows little sign of reaching its finale. As ever, you can catch up on iPlayer with anything you missed. And today there for you is some light relief for a Sunday afternoon with that longer version of our conversation with Hugh Jackman. Thanks as ever for your company. I look forward to seeing you here next week. Goodbye.